So on this table, we have the JD Square Model 32 tube bender. We have the Swag Offroad machine, hydraulic air ram mount for this specific bender. And then from Harbor Freight, we have our 8-ton Pittsburgh hydraulic ram. So today, we're going to be assembling all this stuff and hopefully building a really cool stand to put this tube bender onto. And it's really gonna open up a lot of projects for this channel. So let's just get right into it. So the first thing we're gonna be doing is knocking the pin out of this pressure release valve and replacing it with this knob. Now my pin was bent from the factory and this needs to get installed into this knob and it goes through that valve. So I'm gonna try to straighten this out as much as possible before reinstalling it. Next, we can remove this hand pumping assembly. We just need to remove the three cotter pins on the back and that'll release this whole thing. We're gonna go ahead and reinstall this pin. We're gonna slide it through this flat washer, slide it in here, and we're gonna install a cotter pin on the backside. All right, so we're done with the cylinder for now, so I'm gonna set it aside. Next, we're gonna install these studs into this little collar here. I'm gonna be using anti-seize. I wanna be able to get these off in the future if I do decide to tear this whole thing apart. Now, these need to be installed hand tight. You don't wanna go any further than that. The arms of the bender are gonna keep them on. And then this short stud here gets installed on the side with the Swag logo. And then the longer stud will just get installed on the opposite side. In order to get the cylinder into this collar, we're gonna have to spread it apart. Now, Swag Offroad provides you with this piece of 1/8-inch sheet metal. We need to get that right into the groove. So we're gonna use a screwdriver, we're gonna hammer it into the side here, start spreading that collar, and then we're gonna insert this piece of 1/8-inch sheet metal right down into that groove. Now, this piece of sheet metal does need to be driven down below these holes. We're gonna be installing the bolts to push on that plate, but you do wanna be sure that you don't drive it down too far and go below the inner wall here. We're gonna go ahead and install 2 of the 2-inch bolts, they're the longer ones, into the threaded side of these holes. And what that's gonna allow us to do is push against the plate and spread this clamp even further. I applied a little bit of anti-seize on both of these bolts to keep them from seizing up. We can get our collar installed onto the cylinder now. Now I removed the sticker on the backside because this collar was gonna be covering up half of it and I'm not a barbarian, I want this thing to look good. Now the side of this collar with the short stud, that's gonna go in a line with our knob. And then these screws here, we're just gonna tighten them down just enough to where this collar will slide on. You don't wanna go too tight with this, but they don't really need a whole lot. So we'll just get those, yep, just like that.
So I'm just gonna look down this thing and try to eyeball this the best that I can, making sure that this little short stud is in line with that knob. And once I get it where I want it, I'll go ahead and loosen these screws and then I'll remove this little piece of sheet metal in here. Now, one more thing, when lining this collar up, you want this collar right on the edge of the rounded part of the cylinder. So basically slide it back until you don't have a gap in here and that's where you want it. You don't want it too far back, but you also don't want it too far forward where you have a gap underneath this little rounded part. So I got this plate basically out, but I'm just gonna go ahead and double check my alignment before removing it completely. Cause once that plate's out, that's gonna clamp pretty good.
Once this thing's in place, we're going to install 3 of our 1-inch bolts here. And these are gonna get torqued down to 25 foot-pounds. I think the way I'm gonna do this is build out the swinging arm assembly first, get that attached to the cylinder. So these are the parts we're gonna need, and the things to take note of are this 3/4-inch bolt here that came from the JD Square kit, and then this 1/2-inch bolt here that came from the Swag kit. As far as the arms go, this piece here is marked top, so this goes facing up and this is the top plate, and then the bottom one just mirrors it.
To build this out, we're gonna take our spacer, and then we also need to install the little spring here. And then we're gonna insert the bolt. So you're gonna have the bolt, a washer, and then the arm. And this is gonna get inserted through everything. And then on the bottom, we have a washer, and then our nut.
So we're about ready to attach this arm to the cylinder. So I just put it up onto some wood to get it off the table and make it a little easier to install. Both of these spacers will get installed into our cylinder, but we need to grease them up first. And I'm not sure where that arm's gonna wanna pivot. It may wanna pivot here, or it may wanna pivot where it's actually contacting the cylinder. So I'm gonna grease up both of those locations before I get it all installed.
All right, so this is gonna be a little bit tricky. Need to try to get all of this installed kind of at the same time. So we'll put our first spacer in and get that down on the cylinder. Both of these bolts are getting torqued down to 40 foot-pounds, and just to keep these arms in perfect alignment, I installed two pins on either end, and that should just help hold everything together and ensure we're nice and straight. Next, we'll install this lower arm, and it gets installed with this threaded bolt facing down. And be sure to grease up that stud, as this is going to be a wear point. Now I'm going to put these nuts on, and I'm just going to keep it loose because I haven't built my stand yet. But if you have a stand, you can go ahead and throw the tube bender on there now, or otherwise this is where that mounting plate would attach. It's going to attach right here, and then of course you have your washer and then a nut that goes on the bottom. Make sure that the upper stud is greased up and install the upper arm, and it gets installed with the lettering face up. And then install a washer and a nut onto that. All right, now we can install the second bolt into this upper arm. We're gonna go ahead and slide this spacer in between. And we're gonna run the bolt and a washer down through. Then a nut and a washer on the bottom. Just to note, this nut that goes on top here, there's actually like a little shorty guy, so that's where that little short nut goes. Now the directions say you might need a buddy to get this return spring on, but when you're as strong as me, you don't need a buddy. So I was messing around with this thing and it was not extending fully, so I'm gonna add some hydraulic oil in it and hopefully that helps it out. So I think that's all that problem, so if you're not getting the full stroke out of that cylinder, just add oil. I'm gonna leave the tube bender here for now and I'm gonna start working on the stand. So if you're only here to see how this bender goes together, go ahead and skip forward a little bit. Otherwise, let's start working on the stand. So I'm gonna be using some of these pieces here for my stand. This is 2x2 120 wall. Now all this stuff is pulled out of the scrap bin. So as you can see, there's a bunch of tubes welded on and then some of these pieces over here have brackets welded on. So all this is gonna need cleaned up. So at this point, I still have no idea how I'm gonna build the stand. I don't know what I want it to look like, but I know how I'm gonna start it. I got these two pieces of plate here. This 2-inch tube is gonna get welded to those. And then this piece here that the actual bender gets bolted to is gonna get welded up top here. And I'm gonna drill four holes in the bottom of this base plate. That way, if I ever need to remove the bender, I can just unbolt it from these two plates rather than unbolting it from the top here, which means I'd have to unbolt and take apart that bender. The first thing we're gonna have to do is weld the nut onto the backside of this plate, because once we get this welded to this tube, there's not gonna be a way to get a wrench on the back of that. Got everything pretty much ready to weld. This tube has been cut down, so hopefully that is tall enough, but also I wanted to keep it pretty short, so I'm gonna weld all this stuff together. This piece is just about done. The last thing I wanna do is capture all these nuts and just tack them onto the bottom of this plate. I'm a big fan of just capturing nuts when you can, that way you're not fumbling with two wrenches and all that nonsense. Piece is looking real good, real beautiful. Nuts have been captured. So I guess I just gotta figure out how I'm gonna build the rest of this thing. So I got the welding jacket on, which means we have a lot of welding to do, a lot of grinding and cutting to do. So I ran out yesterday, I grabbed two more sticks, I had 2-inch tubing. I grabbed some flat stock to mount the casters. I also ran out and got some more gas in the welder, got a brand new bottle, so that's pretty cool. So we are basically ready to weld. And then last night, I spent most of the night trying to teach myself Bentec software, and I got most of this stand pretty much designed. And now the reason I'm using Bentec, despite not having any bends in this stand whatsoever, is just the fact that those uprights on both the top and bottom are gonna have some pretty complex cuts. And Bentec likes to print out these wrappers. So I'll basically have this piece of paper that I wrap around the tube, and that'll tell me exactly where I need to cut it. So I got a list of all the tubes I need to cut and their length. And then I also got all my wrappers printed and cut. I think we're ready to build this thing. Now, unfortunately, the flattest, squarest surface I have in this shop is this table here. So I'm gonna tack everything on this table, try to get it as square and flat as possible, and then we'll move it somewhere else and get it fully welded. So we'll go ahead and start with the base. Base is done, so we'll get started on the little square upper piece next. This piece here is completely boxed in the entire way around. I pretty much had to do that because that front support's gonna sit right here, and then that back one's gonna come up right here, and it's gonna contact all three of those sides. So I just need a surface here to weld on. Now I can go ahead and get this piece in. So I want this top plate to sit flush to the top of here. I think that way it'll look the best. So I'm probably gonna tack this in flush, flip it over and weld that bottom plate, unbolt it, break everything apart. And that should be pretty good. Feels so good when everything goes exactly as planned. That's exactly how I want it. I'm real happy with that. Now comes the tricky part. I have to figure out how to use these wrappers. Now I think I got it figured out. They make it pretty darn simple. So I'm gonna get this one traced out and I'll kinda show you the gist of how they work. All right, so on each wrapper they give you two dimensions. They give you a dimension from the end of the tube to the wrapper. So for this wrapper here on the left, you would measure from the right end of the tube all the way down to this line on the actual wrapper itself. And then the same thing for this one on the right, you'd measure from the left end of the tube all the way down to this line. And then they give you a second dimension, and that is just from this line to this line, and that's just to pretty much double check your work. Now there's one last thing we need to pay attention to. There is a line that runs long way with the tube on both wrappers. In our case, since we're using square tubing, that's gonna be dead center of the tube. Now if you're using round tubing, it doesn't matter where you're at. You just have to make sure that this line is perfectly in line with this line. Now both ends of this tube have been marked out, so I'm gonna go ahead and get it cut out, and hopefully this fits. First piece is cut, and that is absolutely beautiful. Let's go mock it up. All right, so this piece is gonna sit somewhere in here, and then this top piece, I should have made it lighter, is gonna sit like so. That's gonna work. I guess now we just got three more of these puppies to cut out. So I'll see you in a bit. All right, all the pieces are cut. It is late, and the shop is absolutely destroyed. So that sounds like it's a problem for tomorrow. I'm just gonna turn the lights off and pretend that it's just not like this. Maybe it'll clean itself. All right guys, so you might have noticed that the garage is significantly cleaner. Some magic little gnomes came, cleaned everything up for me. So that was pretty cool. Now this is about 2 weeks from when I last filmed. Ran into a bunch of issues last weekend where we had some kid in the neighborhood. He broke into about 5 or 6 cars. And of course, our car was one of them. When I say broke into it, it was unlocked, but got all that footage to the police, had to deal with all that, so kind of delayed us a little bit. But today went ahead and cleaned up all these parts, so we're pretty much ready to get everything tacked into place. I imagine that the next few minutes here are gonna be mostly just kind of getting things fit up, trimming a little bit where things need trimmed, and taking a lot of measurements to make sure everything's nice and square. This thing is tacked together. All the gaps look very good, very happy with it. So I'm gonna double check all the dimensions on it, make sure we're good, everything's square, and we'll get it burned in. She is fully welded and she is a beefy girl. So if there's ever a tornado, you can probably find me curled up in a little ball underneath this thing. Now the beautiful thing about having a hydraulic tube bender is that you don't have to bolt it to the floor. You can use casters. So I got four casters here. We can go ahead and make some mounts to mount to the bottom of the frame. And that way we'll be able to roll that whole thing around. All the plates to mount the casters are complete. So the casters are just gonna sit right on top of these nuts like so, and then they'll get bolted down. So the only thing I need to do is drill three holes per caster into the frame, and that way those bolts will be able to pass right through there.
One down, three to go.
So that took a while, but I am pretty happy with how this thing turned out. Now I'm not completely done. There is a few more things I want to do to this thing. I want to add some rods on the backside here to hang up the dies as I get more of them. And then I also want to build some brackets off of this thing to help hold some of the pins. But I've never used a tube bender before, so I'm not entirely sure the best place to put all that stuff. So I'm gonna assemble this thing, and then as I use it, I'll be able to kind of figure out where I wanna put all that. So I pretty much built this entire thing with this bracket facing forward, thinking that that was the front of it, but I actually think that this bracket hangs off the back here, and then that way, the die of the bender will be hanging out on the front end of this stand. So lucky for me, this is symmetrical, so we're just gonna flip that around real quick, and hopefully that's the right way. All of these bolts get torqued down to 40 foot-pounds. Should be able to get the die in here now. Pin is a little tight, but hopefully it'll loosen up as we use it. And with the die in place, we can go ahead and install the longer 7/8 pin, and that just goes right here. The second 1¼-inch pin, that is for the follow bar. And then that follow bar is labeled top, so you just want to make sure that that is facing up. That gets installed like so. The shorter 7/8 pin will get installed here for the U-clamp. All right, I'm going to spin this die all the way around. And that way, I'll be able to install this little locking mechanism. And that's going to get installed from the bottom here. We'll go ahead and spin the die back around. And that little collar goes on top. And there is a set screw that we will need to tighten. I'm just gonna set that pin all the way down on the die and tighten up this little set screw. All right, and that way as this die goes along, it'll be able to lift up that pin, then it'll drop in, and then it'll lock that die into place. The dial indicator gets installed face up, of course, and then there's a 1-inch washer and a 1-inch nut that holds it onto the bottom. Now we can take this TIG rod and bend it around here. You're gonna want it to come down and point right at this dial indicator, and then as you bend it, that'll show you exactly what degree
you bent that tube at. Now that rod's gonna look a little something like this, but I'm not gonna bend it until I am ready to actually use this tube bender. I cannot be happier. The stand is built, the bender is pretty much assembled. Now I just need to figure out how in the world to use this thing. So if you wanna join me along that journey, make sure you hit that like and subscribe button. That'll help out the channel, and I could definitely use the money because DOM tubing is extremely expensive, and that's what we're gonna be building the roll cage out of for the Reaper. As always, thank you guys for watching, and I will see you on the next one.